Good morning and happy Sabbath. Welcome to Vienna. Today you have made a choice to worship the creator of the universe. Our Sabbath school lesson this quarter, if those who haven't collected this, there's plenty in the library, is about a choice that had to be made in heaven, whether to go with God, Jesus, or to go with Lucifer. We make choices every day. And right now, we choose to worship. So welcome to worship, welcome to Vienna, and welcome to the presence of God. Today, to help with our worship is Leticia Nakonya, who will be reading the scripture. If you could all please stand for the scripture reading. Oh, sorry. It's for the prayer, sorry.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Happy Sabbath. Thank you so much. Let's bow our head for an opening prayer. Lord, our Father, we thank you so much for this blessed day, the Sabbath day. We are grateful, Lord, for the opportunity to come together today to worship you. We thank you for everyone who is here today because we know, Lord, it's because of your grace we are here today. Without that, we would not be here, Lord. Thank you so much for inviting us to come here and worship you. Thank you, Lord, because you love us. You created us so we can worship you. Thank you so much for also those who are online, Lord. Bless them, Lord. I pray for those who could not make it today, but wanted to make it today here or online. Lord, our Father, bless them. Touch them. Embrace them and hug them with your love and be with them in everything they do, Lord. On this blessed day, I ask you, Lord, please bless our preacher. Please use him for your glory, Lord. Help us to pay attention and get the message that he prepared for us through you. Our Father, we ask you, Lord, when we leave this place, we'll all feel blessed, and above all, we'll have the joy that only comes from you. I pray that in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Please remain standing for our opening song, In Christ Alone.
Please join me. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, my hope is found. My light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, seated.
So good to be here on this beautiful Sabbath day. It's nice to see your beautiful faces. Everyone is smiling, and most everyone is sitting up front. We are so glad that you are here. My name is Pastor Colsey Joseph, and I'm here to welcome you into the building. We are Vienna, a place that exists to reach out to the forgotten, to bring them to follow Jesus into forever. Can we say amen to that mission? Amen. I'm so excited to be here. We are excited because we are expanding God's kingdom. We are excited that many of you have expanded in your giftedness in service. And this month, Pastor Vinny and I will be touching a different subject, a subject that will help you grow in your journey. How many of us want to have a deeper relationship with the Lord? How many of us want to grow in faith? This month, we're going to challenge you to have a unique experience. And at the end, there are going to be some testimonies. You're going to experience some things that you've never experienced before if you journey with us. I'm looking forward to the word with Pastor Vinny. And also, it's really good to see you back in the house, preacher. I know you were in the building last week. The saints were praying for you, and we are so glad that you are here. Just a brief message for those who are first-time guests in the building. If you need to make yourself comfortable, simply exit the center or either aisles in the back of the building. Make your way to the right. You will see the ladies' room along the wall on the right side. And if you go around the corner, you'll see the men's room as well, too, along the right side, my right side, as you go out and exit that way as well, too. Now we're going to just have a quick administrative detail. For those who are seasoned saints at Vienna, you're probably used to this happening at the end of the service, but we're making a change. So we're having the first reading for membership transfers here at the beginning of the service. So just pay attention to the names, and then next week we'll have the second reading as well. So you want to make sure that if you want to be a part of this vote action, you want to get in at 11 o'clock so you can be a part of it. So we have the first reading for membership transfer into Vienna. Hannah Blake will be coming from Fort Myers down in Florida, and she's joining our congregation. And we have two who are leaving our congregation to serve at Manassas SDA Church. And that is Douglas Tavis and Anna Tavis. Those are the two. So this is the first reading, and then next week we will have the second reading. Now, you know when I'm here, I always ask you to reach into your pocket and to grab your phone. So I'm going to ask everyone to reach into your pocket. Grab your smartphone. It doesn't matter if it's an Android, if it's an Apple phone, even if you have a Windows phone. You can grab your phone, reach it, and hold it high. First thing that I want you to do is I want you to flick the silent button on your phone. You're going to turn off your ringer, so that way, as you worship, you're not going to be distracted at all. While you do this, I want you to keep your phone up as well. We're going to put a sign on the screen to invite you to join the Pastor's Corner. The Pastor's Corner is an email that goes out every week that lets you know everything that's happening here at church. So I'm just going to wait for Avi to put up the Pastor's Corner. I know they're busy in the back working miracles. We're going to give you the opportunity to use your phone. You can scan the QR code. They're working miracles. There you go. So with your phone right now, you can sign up to the Pastor's Corner, and you simply scan that QR code with your phone, and you will provide your name, your email address, and then also one bit more of information if you want to, and you can receive the Pastor's Corner. Let me tell you, it goes out to 434 readers right now. And you could be on the mailing list, and you'll never miss out another event that is happening here at church. So simply scan it, and you'll be able to join it. Now, after you signed up, you're going to have your browser open anyways. So what we're going to ask you to do is one last thing. There's one last favor. I know Pastor's asking you to do a lot of tech stuff today. Don't worry. The Holy Spirit is with you. While you have your browser open, you're going to go to wearevienna.church. Our website. We want you to simply scroll down to worship with us, and we want you to go onto our YouTube channel and say hello, world. You want to greet all the saints that are worshiping online. And for those who are online, we are so glad that you chose this space to worship with us as well. So we're going to greet our saints who are online. And while you're on our YouTube channel, if you haven't subscribed yet, I'm looking for just 3 people to subscribe. How many people did I say? 3. So if you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, we want 3 people to subscribe. Now, you're probably saying, Pastor, why is it that you're asking for only 3? Because with the next 3 individuals, we're going to hit a subscription list of 200. Okay, you guys are not excited. 200 subscribers on our YouTube channel. So we're just looking for 3 individuals to subscribe. We'll hit this threshold of 200. Our goal is to get as many subscribers as possible, but today we're just looking for 3. So if you're one of the 3, go ahead and subscribe. You'll never miss one of our worship services. Say hello to the world. And finally, after I've asked you to do all these wonderful things, I'm going to ask you to do one more thing. I'm going to ask you to stand. And as you stand, you're going to greet the person next to you or near you for the next 30 seconds. And once you hear the sound of music, you know that it's time for us to continue with our worship service. Happy Sabbath. Thank you.
don't know about each of you, but this week I'm reminded that even though things like earthquakes might happen, right, God is still protecting me and shielding me under his wings. Our next song is Still. Join me. Shines rise and thunders roar.
It is that time of the service where we get together to pray and worship with our concerns and our praises. If you have been looking at the news or even just living in this world, you know that we have had a lot of calamities in the last week. We had an earthquake in Taiwan. We had an earthquake in New York. We have wars that are devastating multiple countries. We have personal tragedies and personal concerns that overwhelm us. We also have a lot of things to praise God for. We have a church to worship in, the freedom to worship. We have life. We also have a God who is always, always willing to hear us, whatever our concerns may be. And I want to direct your thoughts towards in John chapter 17. It is a prayer that Jesus prayed before he was crucified, and it was a prayer for his disciples. Each one of us is a disciple, and it would be really powerful to read that prayer because it is meant for each one of us as well. I would just like to read one verse from there, John chapter 17, verse 15, which says, "I do not ask you to take them out of the world, but I do ask you to keep them safe from the evil one." Let us come together for those who want to come forward as we pray as a congregation to give us the strength and the courage to overcome the evil one. Please kneel. Our Father, which art in heaven, we are grateful for an opportunity to come before you with our thanksgiving and our praise. We ask thee to give us the strength we need each day to make the right choices, to always be the one that we choose. Be with us as we learn more about you each day. We especially ask you to be with our fellow brothers and sisters who are suffering great calamities, who have poor health, those who are struggling with finances and other concerns that overwhelm them. The devil tries so hard to distract us with the things of this world that we lose sight of our ultimate goal. Give us the courage to step forth in faith, knowing that you always take care of us and you have our best interest in mind. Help us to encourage each other and forgive us, Lord, for the many times that we have fallen short. We ask thee to dwell in our hearts as we worship with you today. In Jesus' name. Amen. I would like to invite the deacons forward. The other day I was standing out in the yard with a friend, and I could hear a very distinct sound in the background. And it was a bird, and I know many of you are familiar with the bird that makes the sound. Any guesses? It was a woodpecker. We actually see a lot in this area. Beautiful birds, the ones that I think they call the pleated woodpecker, they have a red forehead. So I was so happy because I love woodpeckers. And I said to the friend, oh, we have a woodpecker. I wish I could see it. And the friend said, the sound of a woodpecker is not that happy sound. Because when you hear a woodpecker, it means there's a dead tree somewhere close by. So sometimes something that is beautiful also gives us an idea of the health of something that we don't probably think about. That made me think about our church. A healthy church has good finances. And good finances come from a healthy congregation, a congregation that puts God first. So I challenge you, as the pastors are going to challenge you this month, to examine your relationship with your God and say, what part of your finances that influences? Because at the end of it, what really matters? As you reach into your pockets and you write your checks and you go online to worship with your offering, consider what God has done for you. I would also like you to direct your attention to the cubbies that you have seen on either side of the church. There is a list in the bulletin. This is another way that you can serve and give part of your offering. There is a list of items that the community services has requested. You are most welcome to share and bring something to share with those who are less fortunate. Let us pray for the offering. Father, you have given us so generously, blessed us with homes to live and food to eat, to freedom to work, and also health. Help us in turn to bless you with our service, with our life, and with our treasures. We anticipate and know that you will bless us more than we can ever expect, because you are a faithful God who takes care of his people. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we talked, praise the Lord. Yeah, and it's just what the slide says, right? What's the slide say? To what? Too blessed to be pressed. So even if we have to now sip tea,
And even if we have to stand still, maybe this is the Lord telling me not to exert all my energy on the first week. God calls us all to have a spiritual gift. And the last thing I asked you for was a list while I was gone of how you were going to use your spiritual gifts in the church when I came back. I'm waiting for your list. But I'm too blessed to be pressed. We're going to spend this month, Pastor Coastley and I and all of you, learning about what it means to be blessed by God. And what happens to us spiritually in our stewardship capacity when we experience God's blessings in our life. And so, as odd as it sounds, my very first sermon in our series on stewardship is called Stop Giving. Now, I expected to get more of a reaction. I expected someone to say, "Hallelujah, it's about time." But I want to bring our attention to our old friend Moses. And I want to talk to you about an experience that anyone who has been in leadership understands. Moses faced a lot. Would you say that? Y'all know Moses, right? Yeah, he's the guy that, you know, people say I might have went to high school with as my beard gets gray. Moses was the guy that God called to lead Israel out of captivity. But Moses had a problem. The problem was that God's ability to call Moses and to lead his people out of captivity worked. And so now Moses is out there in the desert with a bunch of people who have their own ideas about what should happen next. And so they begin to complain and they begin to murmur. I mean, it's like we want to go back to captivity. Can you imagine? We want to go back to the good old days where all we had to do is slave making bricks. We don't like the uncertainty of not knowing when is the next time we will have quail and leeks. And then, of all things that could happen to a spiritual leader, he goes off to a spiritual retreat called by God himself, and he comes back and he finds them worshiping a golden calf. Moses has a problem. And when Moses talks to God and Moses says, "God, what do I do about these people who want to go back to the way it was? They have forgotten how hard it was to make bricks without straw. They want quail and leeks and onions and golden shiny gods that are cows." And so God says to Moses, "Make a a sanctuary for my people that I will dwell right there with them. You see, when we're disobedient, God's reaction is to draw closer, not further from us. I don't think you heard me today. When we get it wrong, God comes to get it right in our home. And so God said to Moses, build a sanctuary, and I will dwell amidst the people who want quail and leeks and onions and shiny calves, and I will make my glory known. And they will worship me. Because God says this is actually a heart problem. The Lord spoke to Moses saying, tell the sons, and I'm going to add daughters, of Israel to take up a contribution. Now, come on, you good Adventist people. You know what he means when he says take up a contribution, right? It means to contribute, to give an offering. Tell them to take up a contribution. Now, not for the Levites, not for Aaron, not for Moses. God calls upon them to give of their own means for the cause of God. From everyone whose heart moves him, they shall give a contribution. Now, I'm not a medical person, but I obey them and I drink my tea. And I close up my spill-proof mug. But I'm pretty sure if you walked into the sanctuary today, your heart moved. I'm hearing some amens from the doctors in the crowd. My biology is not that far off. So God says this problem of disobedience, this problem of disarray, this problem of disorganization of my movement out of slavery, even this problem of wanting to go backwards, can be taken care of by checking the pulse of your people. But Moses is like, my people are recently freed slaves. So Moses like, God, why you always do this to me? This is like the burning bush all over, God. Why are you asking these big things of me? Moses is like, you want me to go to my people who are freed slaves. They don't even have their own land yet. They're still in the Hebrew Jim Crow times. You want me to tell them to give, just what should they give? And God is just like, Moses, I'm so glad you asked. Here's what I want them to give. This contribution, which you are to take from them, should be gold, silver, bronze, violet, purple, scarlet material, linen, goat hair, ram skins dyed red. God getting really particular. Leather, Arcadia, he's not done. Oil for lighting, balms of oil for the anointing and for the fragrance of incense, onyx stones and setting stones for the ephod of the breastplate of the priests. When God asks, he don't ask small. And he doesn't ask what you have to give, because he gives you what he asks you to give. And the next thing he says after that hefty list is, have them construct a sanctuary for me, so that I may dwell among them. And this is the truth, friends. God wants to dwell with you. This is the truth, friends. God wants to live in this building with us. He wants to live in our building. He wants to live in our homes. He wants to live in our workplace. He wants to live in our hearts. And he wants to live in our worship. Because this was never about God needing gold or silver or bronze. This was actually about them needing their golden calf. And God is like, if you're going to build golden calves, are I a secondary God to you? And many people are busy building their own version of the golden calf. And God is just asking, when will you worship me? Didn't Jesus tell us? No man can serve two masters. No man can serve both God and mammon, which is just an old King Jamesy phrase for money. He will love one and hate the other. And all God is asking is, when will you make me the object of your gold? And the truth is, we all think shiny golden things are great. And we don't know what God is calling us to that is greater. So Moses got on it, and Moses was like, let's get on this right away. This is God's message to his people. And Moses summons Bezalel and Oholiab and every skilled person whom the Lord had given ability. What? Given what? Ability. Oh, their divine design, their spiritual gift. And who was willing to come and do the work? In every church will be those who were designed to do a certain work. And in every church will be those who were designed to do a certain work who won't do it. And that's why, unfortunately, Moses had to put the second phrase in the sentence. Those who God has given the ability. And who are willing to do. To come and do the work. They receive from Moses all of the offerings of the Israelites. So they're giving what? They're giving their service. They're giving their skills. They're giving their heart. They're giving their sweat. They're giving their tears. They're out there and they're greeting people at the doors and they're even putting their name tags on. And they're setting up chairs in the fellowship hall. And they're figuring out how to get the sanctuary heated to the right temperature in their new systems. And they're moving forward doing the work. Because they understand that all of this is simply worship. They received from Moses all the offerings the Israelites brought to carry on the work in constructing the sanctuary. And everything you give to the church is not always shiny. Everything you give to the church is not always gold. Everything you give to the church is not always signed on a check. Everything you give to the church is not always put through together net. Everything you give to the church is not always money. You must also give of your blood, sweat, and tears, and gifts of God that He has given you. And when you do, there will be less of people who just have to be willing because the people with the gift didn't do it. God is on a path to teach Moses. God is on a path to teach Israel. God is on a path to teach His people. You don't need no stinking golden calf. I want to live in your community. And the people, get this. The people, for the first time in history, Shema. Remember what I told you that word means. It means to listen, to hear, and if you listen and hear and you know it's from God, you just do what? Obey. Watch what happens when God's people get serious about His Shema. So the skilled workers, it's the skilled workers, not just the people who are willing. The skilled workers came to work. Someone should say, hallelujah. The skilled workers who were doing all, how much of the work? Come on, Vienna. They're getting serious about God's call on their life, and they're not just leaving it up to those who are willing. We don't want a youth Sabbath school teacher who's just willing. We want one who's called and skilled. So all the skilled workers who were doing the work on the sanctuary left what they were doing. Watch this, watch this, watch this. Left what they were doing. You watching? And said to Moses, the people are bringing more than enough. Oh, I don't think you heard me. Moses took up an offering and the deacons came to Moses and said, "Our offering plates are not big enough." Tell the people to stop filling them so full. The people are bringing more than enough for doing the work of the Lord, doing the work the Lord commanded to be done. You see, when our giving is spiritual, come on, we made it too warm in here for you now. When our giving is spiritual, when our giving is focused on worship, then we will have more than enough. I'm waiting for the Sabbath. I'm waiting for the Sabbath. I am waiting for the Sabbath when I say to the church, stop giving to debt reduction because we have more than enough. The bill is paid. And if Hebrew slaves still living in Hebrew Jim Crow could produce more than enough, I'm pretty sure that those who can afford to live in Northern Virginia can do the same thing when everybody gives according to how their heart beats. That's not a number, that's not a figure, that is according to if you wake up and find that your heart is still beating. You have reason to worship. So Moses got to live the pastor's dream. Moses stood up before the congregation and gave them an order and sent this word throughout the campus. No man or woman is to make anything else as an offering to the debt reduction of the sanctuary. That was Moses, that was them, that was not me or us. But it could be. Because God has not changed. God never asks from you what he doesn't first provide for you. If God asked you to give something, God puts it in your hand to give it. Which one of you ever sent your kid to Sabbath school and said, make sure you give an offering, but didn't first clasp their hand and put that offering in their hand and then sent them to Sabbath school knowing that they would do the right thing with that money? God is not asking you to give what you do not have. He's saying, if you give, I will make sure you have it to give. No man or woman is to take anything else as an offering for the sanctuary and the people. Are you following me? And so the people were what? What's the word? I made it big, yellow, and underlined. So the people were what? The deacons, just as good a shape as they were in, and as many calisthenics and exercises that they did, they just were not able to lift those offering plates anymore because of how full they were. And the people were restrained from giving more, from bringing more, because what they had already, what they already had was more than enough to do all the work. I once had a pastor. I was just a new elder at the time. We had built a new school, and we were having problems with the payments for the new school we had built. And the pastor got up front, and the pastor said, "I got good news, everyone. I found the money to pay off the school." And everyone started applauding and clapping. And, you know, I thought Jubilee was going to break out. And he said, "The bad news is that it's still in your pockets." But if I knew then what I know now, I would say, but if your heart still beats, you will give from your worship. When you give from your worship, when you give out of your gratitude, when you give because God keeps your heart going, and this is not about the amount right now, this is about giving from your heart. And everyone does their part. Ooh, that could have been a sermon title. This is about giving from your heart, and everyone does their part. Man, I need to edit myself. I'm giving you two sermons for the price of one. That's what happens when you don't preach for 4 weeks. Listen, the widow's mite was more money than the rich young ruler ever gave Jesus. Come on, church! The widow's mite was more money than the rich young ruler ever gave Jesus. Because the rich young ruler had everything and didn't give a penny. He'd rather walk away from Jesus. So don't be discouraged. It's not from what you have that matters. It is from what your heart convicts you of that matters. And now I arrive at the part of the sermon that no one wants to hear, but I'm gonna preach it anyways, because I'm just a good conservative herbal tea drinking Adventist pastor now. Lid closed. And I still believe in the words of our pioneers. Deny yourself 1,000 things rather than run in debt. This has been the curse of your life, getting into debt. Avoid it like you would avoid the plague. Any of you good tea drinking, herbal tea drinking Adventists, it's growing on me. Still love those little red books. I find it interesting that we never quote this one. Deny yourself 1,000 things rather than run in debt. And I'm not just talking about the church, so heads up, I'm talking about your home too. I'm talking about your car payment too. I'm talking about your mortgage too. I'm talking about your family budget too. Deny yourself a thousand things rather than to run in debt. This has been the curse of your life. Don't be cursed. We're too blessed to be pressed, right? God is attempting to bless his people, but we are turning his blessings into curses. We're like, God gave me a little bit more, so let me find out what I can do with it. I'm going to Chick-fil-A twice this week. Oh, I don't do that anymore. Avoid debt like smallpox that killed hundreds and thousands in her day. So, great Adventist pioneers, thank you very much. You've given us this message about 20 years too late, or at least before we put it on the screen. So what do we do if we are already in debt? Oh, they have an answer for everything, these Adventist pioneers. But we don't get the answer because we don't want to read the problem. You know what I'm talking about? But there is an answer. Because maybe you got some credit card debt. Maybe you overspent on your transportation loan. Maybe your mortgage is running a little bit too high, and I totally get it because I couldn't even afford a mortgage here. Not on what the good little Adventist system gives us. She says, make a solemn. Solemn means serious for those of you who are not into old English. Make a solemn covenant with God, that by his what? Oh. The other word was curse. So you can turn the curses that you put on your own head into blessings. Too blessed to be pressed. By making a solemn covenant with God, that you will owe no one anything, even if you have to live on porridge. Mercy, as Cosley would say. And then she says this, do not falter. Be discouraged. Or turn back. Are you hearing me? Because Moses didn't falter. Even when they griped about wanting to go back to Egypt, he refused to be discouraged. Even when they worshiped the golden calf, he did not turn his back on them or the mission. Moses simply made giving an act of worship. I think my slide is stuck here, but I'm going to just finish up without changing it if it doesn't change, because I think this is an image God may want us to look at. If people escaping Egypt could afford to find a way to build a sanctuary that brought honor and glory and praise to Yahweh all over the Middle East and through the world. I am convicted. Those in Vienna can build ministries and ministry teams and ministry budgets and get rid of debt and build the place that will honor and glorify Yahweh all over Northern Virginia. If we worship with our hearts beating. I can tell you this right now. There are those who do not give. There are those who give only the tithe, nothing to the local church. By the way, they are not the same thing. And there are those who give to everything. But I wait for the day when everybody's heart beats as one in Vienna for the mission of God. And I don't care if you have 2 copper coins or 2 checks. But that you give out of your sense of worship. Because then I will stand before you one day and say, enough. Stop giving. Our debts are paid. If I've given AV enough notice, there be a video now. And I would invite you to watch the video as the praise team comes forward to give you the song. And I'm just going to stay here a second to see that the video is coming.
Who am I? This is a question you have certainly asked yourself before. And while there are many ways to come to an answer, as Christians, we can always answer this question by simply affirming that we are members of God's family. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. At first glance, some people might argue that this kind of answer might be too easy. However, being called to be part of God's family holds much more meaning than it seems. God is not only the creator of everything, he is also the provider of everything we need. And while he graciously gives us all that we need, his greatest gift of all is his son, Jesus. It's through Jesus' sacrifice that we find a sense of purpose and meaning to life. Being a member of God's family has far-reaching implications. As members of God's family, we should do more than love and obey the creator. We must also share the privilege and responsibility of carrying out his will on earth. As family, there are no natural boundaries between us. This makes us daughters, sons, sisters, brothers, and stewards of the same heritage. In order to thrive in these roles assigned to us by Christ, he wisely left us instructions on how to properly carry out this mission. In Matthew 6:19, while talking to a rich young ruler, Jesus instructed him on how to best use his worldly means. If you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come follow me. As members of God's family, we must also head this instruction and invest in eternity. We must use our blessings to bless others and allow nothing to prevent anyone from following Jesus. After all, the real treasure is not our financial resources or goods here on earth, but the blessings that will come when God's family is reunited. God has created and redeemed us to be his stewards. So let's study the Bible daily and grow in together in God.
Please sing.
stand and sing our closing song, Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Has always been about
the worship of our hearts. Is God blessing your heart? Is God being faithful to your heart? Are you waking up with your heart still beating and still hungering for more? Let us worship Him. There are those who don't give. There are those who only give to tithe. And there are those who are left carrying the weight. But God's design is that He blesses you. And ask that you only give out of your heart's worship because of the blessing He gave you. I have a blessing. The blessing is, I think this is the first time I've ever been able to button up this jacket. Which means I have a little bit more money now to give to Jesus. They told me I can't go back to Chick-fil-A. I told you that, right? However God is blessing you, give of your spiritual gifts. Give of your resources. Even if required, give of yourself. There are still people within the hearing of my voice who need to be baptized. This is yet another way to give to God. There's a card in the pew that you can leave with the connection people at the desk at the back. There's a QR code. And there's a link in the weekly newsletter, Pastor's Corner. If you need to decide to be baptized, or if you want to recommit your life to Jesus, do so, because today your heart beats with the blessings of no golden calf, but Yahweh Almighty. Dear Heavenly Father, these are your servants. This is your church. Come and let us make a sanctuary, and may you dwell in our midst. And may your glory from week to week come out of this place. May your glory from week to week come out of this place into the sanctuaries of the hearts of everyone who has worshiped you. And may your glory go all over Northern Virginia and testify of Yahweh, our Jesus, who is mighty. Let our worship reflect this. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Participate in and experience So let's come and find out what that invitation is and how each one of us can be part of that movement. We also have some educational videos that we are going to present to the church. That will be the Sabbath after on the 20th. It is a day which we do not have potluck. Those who are interested in coming and watching the videos, it is a church building video. Please bring a sack lunch so that you can stay after church and watch the video, and we will have a small discussion after we watch each video so that we can understand how we can use the information that we received from the BICSA survey and put it into work in our church so that we can expand, grow, and do what we are here for, bringing disciples to Jesus. And last but not least, the favorite for many is our potluck. Next week, we will be having potluck. So be prepared to bring food for yourself and to share, and prepare to stay and fellowship, meet your fellow church members, get to know each other, and just have a good time spending time with friends. I hope each one of you has a blessed Sabbath. Be safe, and we will meet again soon.